in the name of. The rivalry between TJ Dillashaw and Team Alpha Male is a solid rebuttal to that age-old adage, keep your friends close but your enemies closer. I've made three videos on the many feuds hosted by the Bantamweight division, and those videos were all a joy to make. There was a lot of real animosity and even disdain, but it was mostly within the context of gamesmanship, hype, and psychological warfare. And so every individual involved usually emerged with their personal lives and reputations intact. In the end, they never lost anything more than a fist fight, or at worst, a UFC belt. Unfortunately, this is not that. This conflict goes way beyond gamesmanship. It cut real deep, and it illustrates that when things get personal, it's not your enemies, it's your friends you gotta worry about. They know where to strike. They know all your weaknesses, all your vulnerabilities. If this rivalry taught us anything, it's that a friend can tear you down in ways an enemy could only fucking dream of. No more
shame and misery. Hey, let's get my boy TJ Dillashaw in here to take care of my dirty work now.
You can't take me down. You can't break me down. You can't take me down.
In May 2014, TJ Dillashaw took the Bantamweight belt from Renan Barão in stunning fucking fashion. The victory capped a period of growth and transformation that had characterized the previous 18 months at Team Alpha Male. They were now not only atop the division, but the performance itself represented the tip of the spear, the highest level of mixed martial arts. This should have been a perfect happy ending for the architect of that transformation, Duane Ludwig, who on the heels of the victory was leaving to start building his own team in Colorado. Under his tutelage, Team Alpha Male had outperformed themselves by virtually every metric. Smoother combinations, better economy of movement, more confidence in their strikes, and consequently more knockouts. And critically, all the hard work culminated with the team shaking a perpetual bridesmaid's moniker. They had finally snatched the crown, the Bantamweight belt. But this was no happy ending. In fact, speculation of divisions within the ranks of Team Alpha Male were already rife. Ludwig's departure from the camp had come to light 2 months prior, when Faber advertised a position as head coach. Duane was unhappy about the announcement, feeling Faber had jumped the gun. And in an interview with Bruce Buffer, Duane also alluded to the financial side of being a coach rather than owning your own gym, which caused many fans to correctly speculate that a big part of the split boiled down to money.
Like, I'm doing good. Like, at first, things were rough, for sure. Like, 100%, they weren't easy for me out here. And then made some decisions, some changes, and the team ended up, you know, we renegotiated our deals. It was a little bit different than what I thought it was. So we renegotiated in August, and the guys have been taking care of me. It's not for money. Although, like, I don't make a lot of money in any one thing. Like, I don't make a lot of money from the team. But I do okay from the team, I do okay from my business, I do okay from my seminars, my other things. So together, I do good.
4 days before the Barão fight, Faber went on the MMA Hour. He was complimentary of Duane, but referred to the split as a breath of fresh air, which was an early indication of the tension that would later boil to the surface, and at some point scald almost everyone involved.
Yeah, Duane's did a great job running his practice, and he is passionate about his stuff. You know, we implemented a lot of his drills during our set practices, and it turned out great. But he was a little difficult to deal with here and there, and so actually it's kind of a breath of fresh air to have parted ways.
Exactly what Faber meant by difficult, he would later elaborate on. But at the time, and in light of TJ's performance just a few days later, these comments were initially construed by many as some kind of sour grapes, or even jealousy, on Faber's behalf. Over the next year or so, Martin Kampman stepped in as head coach at Team Alpha Male. Dillashaw defended against Soto, Faber notched up a couple wins, and Duane began building his camp in Colorado. The tension appeared to have subsided, at least publicly. But this was just the calm before the storm. In July 2015, a pretty silly act of hubris on Duane Ludwig's behalf was arguably the spark that ignited the feud, and certainly one that blew up in his face.
Mm-hmm. What separates him from the rest of the very talented guys over there?
He actually wants it. TJ is the only one that actually wants to be a champion. TJ trains a lot harder, a lot more focused than anybody else on the team, period. He wants it. You know, there's just certain people that want it more than others. If he has a stronger drive, a stronger determination, he actually believes he could be champion. He's the one who puts in the extra work, asks the questions, trains a bit harder, takes less breaks. He's the only guy that I feel, he actually, Danny Castillo works really hard as well. Danny overtrains himself. TJ is just very smart on how he trains as well. And I mean, there's just a difference if you see the whole Alpha Male team train and TJ sticks out.
Danny Castillo and TJ Dillashaw were two guys still training with Ludwig, so it was pretty obvious what Duane was doing here. He was selling his camp, advertising the idea that he knew exactly what it took to be champion. Here's what he had to say about Mendes, who had just lost his short-notice fight to McGregor.
Chad, I'll tell you what. No one needs me, but everyone that works with me is going to do better with me than without me, that's for sure. And I feel with the proper camp and with Sage, Chad could be winning the belt, be wearing the belt right now. I mean, there's just some little things that Chad could be doing, and he could be wearing the belt right now.
If he had done one or two things differently, he could be champ. If he trained with me, things would be different. I have a new camp. It's clear what's been implied here. Faber and Ludwig had worked together, but now their personal goals had converged. Now they both want to own gyms. And so in light of how well Ludwig had done with the team, these comments represented a very real threat to Uriah Faber and to Team Alpha Male. Understandably, Duane's comments didn't go down well with his former team. Cody Garbrandt, Andre Philly, and Lance Palmer took shots on Twitter. And a week later, Chad Mendes weighed in. Now, Chad is just about the most level-headed guy in this whole story. If you ever want to hear the voice of reason, just look for what Mendes was saying. Or possibly Benavidez.
No, I don't know what the hell Duane is talking about. And I'm tired of hearing about Duane and him ruling our team, you know? Like, Duane came here to Team Alpha Male for a short amount of time, and Duane, you know, did what he did, but I'd say 95% of our wins when he was here, we would have won anyways. You know, Duane was the type of guy that brought a new style to our team, but we have such a unique team that everybody's such high-level athletes that, you know, anybody can come to this team with a new style, and we're going to pick it up, we're going to learn it, and we're going to use it in fight. So, you know, we made Duane. You know, we put Duane on the map.
In response to the onslaught from Team Alpha Male, Duane made a public apology, in which he expressed huge gratitude for his time on Team Alpha Male. But he also implied that he had been stiffed on the contract and screwed on the business end. Now, I'm not sure if Faber was concerned about Duane's departure as a threat, but he certainly made the most of this opportunity to bury Duane. Uriah went on the MMA Hour and administered a vicious and comprehensive public character assassination. This wasn't just a shots fired scenario. This was a bloody, over-the-top Rambo-style obliteration, lasting 80 fucking minutes. Duane felt like he'd been stiffed on the business end. Well, Uriah felt the exact opposite. He felt he had been bled dry and financially tormented by Duane, on top of a whole host of other grievances. And at this point, he had simply had enough. I brother.
You know,
don't get to live in your own reality. And Duane, like, half-heartedly, delusionally tried to sue the team. Civics. I said, you know, dysfunction follows the guy, and the guy's a bully. And Duane is getting, like, free peanut butter, you know? And so, you know, which he starts selling peanut butter at the front desk at our gym, right? The blatant, like, ex-girlfriend mentality, like, crazy ex-girlfriend of, like, trying to break the team down is just bizarre to me. I don't get it. Until you use me up. And I said, you know, we can do something where, you know, it's this salary or 5% of purses, whichever is larger, you know? Seriously, like, 2 days later, Duane calls me and wants more money. And I said, then he's back in the gym and he's getting his salary. And then he starts charging everybody for private. There's a point where TJ's like, man, I don't know what to do, man. Duane's like bleeding me. And I'm like, I feel bad for the guy. He's selling peanut butter at the front desk.
1 week after that merciless public flogging of Duane Ludwig, the big Irish wrecking ball came rolling through Las Vegas and decimated Dillashaw in the process. Picking up an attention, Connor mocked Dillashaw and called Faber a pussy for not fighting him. Dillashaw, who at the time was keeping his cards close to his chest, was defended by none other than Cody Garbrandt.
But I think you should man up and fight him now. You brought him out of college. You said you brought him up, and then Duane came in, took him from you, and now he's winning the world championship, and you should man up now and get that fight, I feel. That's your only fight, really.
We'll see.
Until I see TJ, I didn't see him here. Would I not say that to that little twerp?
Right,
little snake in the grass,
you
he is. He's a little snake in the grass. Where's the little snake? Do something then. Do something then.
A week or so later, news breaks about Dillashaw moving to Colorado. And that is all the masses needed to know to carry McGregor around on their shoulders as a prophet and to forever dub Dillashaw snake in the grass. A couple words from McGregor, and all of a sudden TJ Dillashaw was somehow the villain in this whole story. I never fucking understood it. TJ made his departure official, Connor gloated, and for very understandable reasons, Faber closed Team Alpha Male's doors on TJ Dillashaw. He also took the opportunity to take some parting shots.
We all know TJ. It's not like, you know, TJ gives back to the team, etc. But he's also, you know, he's about number one.
Yeah.
I mean, when you're in a family environment, you have people that have different little things that are issues, you know. And TJ's thing has been that he has a bad temper and he hurts people in practice and does things that are, you know, he's got like a temper and he doesn't hold back sometimes, right? So I'm like, it doesn't make sense for you to come in and spar with our guys. I've been friends with, you know, people at a bunch of different levels, but from him making a business decision to go someplace where he feels is going to be better for him, that's not the right message for the championship team that I'm trying to build. That's not the right message for the little kids to see, you know, someone that you build up to a champion, then he walks away. That's not a right message when you're letting him come in and spar guys when he loses self-control and actually injures people sometimes, you know? But he made a decision to walk away. That's a big boy decision. It's got to be cut and dry.
Dillashaw went from getting smashed by McGregor and trashed by Faber right into a fight with just the human headache that is Dominick Cruz. And he immediately started exploiting the fresh wounds. By December 2015, Faber had gone from, in my mind, protecting Team Alpha Male to now trying to parlay the split into a title shot and was actually trying to cultivate a beef to hype a fight with Dillashaw. Duane is throwing insults. Nobody's safe from the rapid-fire shit-talking machine Dominick Cruz. The whole division is one hilarious fucking mess.
It's just my opinion that he's being a little bit fake, but, you know, I think that a lot of people would agree. He's kind of saying it himself. He said that he's been beating up Faber for 4 years. He said that himself. I didn't say that. I just kind of alluded to it because I had to ask him, like, I beat up your coach, man. Like, he's like, he's not my coach. I've been beating him up for 4 years. He said that, not me. I was like, whoa, I would never say that about my teammates. My teammates helped me become better. I want to build my teammates up. To me, that's a little lack of loyalty.
I feel like TJ is trying to turn himself into a victim here. I mean, he just basically said, hey, I'm leaving this team, I'm joining another team. And I'm like, all right, cool.
Regardless of whether I like Faber or not, or whether I think he's a turd bucket, it doesn't matter. The point is, it's lack of loyalty that he shows. And that's true.
He's trying to make the personal feud in order to fight TJ because I don't think he can actually earn the right to fight TJ and become the number one contender.
So it's hard for him, and I think he's trying to find, make someone else the bad guy. But, dude, we're friends if you want to be friends.
All right.
Is Zuffa going to let us not fight each other? I think that's probably not going to happen.
Could be a collision course.
So, I mean, he's intelligent. He's smart about things like this in the business side, and the only way he could fight TJ is to make it a personal issue, you know, situation. So
he's just a talker, man.
You're fake, man. You're like Mr. Nice Guy, but it's not real.
Man, I'm ready to shut this guy's mouth.
But Faber Dillashaw was derailed. In January 2016, TJ dropped a razor-close split decision to Dominick Cruz in what must be one of the greatest returns from injury in his sports history. But the steaming pot of animosity continued to boil. TJ got overlooked for an immediate rematch in favor of a higher-profile rubber match between Cruz and Faber. And this only further deepened a divide, with Faber going as far as to accuse both Cruz and Dillashaw of being a pair of fucking juice monkeys.
You're right, Faber. There he is. He's eating my mom's food.
Yeah,
oh, my gosh.
He's on
Do you like my mom's cooking?
Oh, my gosh. The way to a man's heart through his stomach is your mom single, yes or no?
Naughty America.
No, my mother is not single.
Oh,
no. Man.
I'll tell you what has happened. I've seen a drastic change in his body from the very first time that I fought him to a year later when he fought. He took a whole year off and came back all ripped. Then he looked pretty good 2 years ago when he made his long-awaited return physically. And then all of a sudden he's got floppy boobs and back fat. I mean, there's no secret what's going on there.
Dude, I fought TJ Dillashaw for 8 years every day.
Not when it matters. Why don't we ask him that?
Dude, I'll smoke TJ Dillashaw.
Why don't we ask him that?
He looks like a prepubescent little teenager right now because USADA came in. You look like a chubby.
So he's going to go that route, but he was training.
Oh, that is the route.
He was training.
That's complete bullshit. That's actually, I didn't realize it was that serious. No, I mean, I don't know, man. I mean, maybe he's saying I look like a young boy because he's wishing he was that young. You know, he's an old dinosaur in there, but. No, I'm going to have to go back and check that out, but that's complete bullshit. I think he's just trying to, like I said in a couple of other interviews, to stay relevant.
Cruz dispatched a Faber to take the trilogy, while TJ Dillashaw defeated the number 2 ranked Rafaela Sunsau, which would appear to set up the logical and now well overdue rematch. But at UFC 202, 9-0 Cody Garbrandt entered the fray. He had been trading insults back and forth with Cruz in the media. And moments before his fight with Takeya Mizugaki, he ran into Cruz, who was commentating at the event.
No, we're walking into the arena, okay. And I see him just sitting right there. So I went up to him, just let him know, hey, you know.
What'd you say?
I walked up by him. He's like, what's up, man? Like, what, like thought we were cool. I'm like, we ain't cool. What's up, man? Me, motherfucker, you want to sit there and talk shit in the media about me being fatherless and this and that. And then he, like, spouted off, like, F you and all this. And I was like, it's all right, man. I said, hey, I'm going to knock the K out and you're next, man. I said, just get ready for it. I said, can't run. I said, I just slapped you right now. You're like, I got to fight. You know, and he was just trembling in fear. I could feel his body radiating fear.
Garbrandt backed up his words, smashing the fuck out of Mizugaki inside a minute. His third first-round knockout of the year. And from the UFC's perspective, Garbrandt's sensational streak, his star potential, and this little beef was enough for him to skip the queue. After a couple months of Cruz embarrassing Cody in a trash talk, Cody returned the favor in the octagon, destroying Cruz in epic fucking fashion. TJ Dillashaw had brought a UFC belt to Team Alpha Male, and now Cody had not only repeated that feat, but did it against the team's most enduring rival, proving that he had in fact been worthy of his title shot. The performance was so good, and Cruz Dillashaw so close, that Cody appeared to be head and shoulders above the competition. Another man on the same card was TJ Dillashaw. The UFC overlooked TJ, and while they attempted to cash in on grudge matches and potential stars, he had been quietly continuing to clear out the UFC's bantamweight division, with wins over his Sunsau and Lineker. The UFC would have likely overlooked him a third time had Cruz not declined a rematch with Cody. Shortly afterwards, the two were announced as coaches for season 25 of The Ultimate Fighter. This looked like a terrible idea for TJ. He's not great at verbal battles, and he was heading into the lion's den. But this is where the public image of Team Alpha Male took a major hit. The show was a straight-up bipolar clusterfuck. Cody was behaving like an irrational, unhinged lunatic. Justin Buchholz came out of the whole thing looking like a complete joke. I mean, Buchholz actually encouraged TJ to leave Alpha Male and cornered him after he did so. And now, for no obvious reason, he was talking more shit than anyone, threatening to release training footage and just mentally spazzing out all over the fucking place. Team Alpha Male were acting like a camp of MKUltra mind-controlled drones, trigger words snaking aggress. It was interesting to see the entire team not only turn on TJ, but do it in such an incoherent manner. The subject of loyalty over everything had been worked up into a fevered frenzy of mindless, hot-headed gibberish. They were hardly making sense. A lot of viewers re-evaluated the rivalry after the show. The Snake in the Grass nickname lost a little steam, and people began to see this shit for what it was. The vilification of TJ Dillashaw was a fucking witch hunt. And for what? When you boil it all down, TJ Dillashaw committed the cardinal sin of switching camps. That is fucking it. Now, he did do it while being Team Alpha Male's only UFC champion, and yeah, it sent a bad message. So I understand the rationale. But TJ Dillashaw was in a terrible situation. Duane and Faber were pulling in opposite directions. TJ Dillashaw got caught in the middle, while poor old Cody got played like a fucking fiddle. Any more ridiculous, and they'd have had to bring a priest to the set of the Ultimate Fighter. Exercise Cody's demons. Season 25 of the Ultimate Fighter reflected terribly on Team Alpha Male. The tables hadn't exactly been turned, but public perception was far more polarized. But as I said, friends can tear you down in ways an enemy can only fucking dream of. Team Alpha Male had a couple arrows left in their little arrow pouch, whatever the fuck it's called, and they weren't finished airing TJ's dirty laundry just yet. After rescheduling to facilitate a Cody Garbrandt injury, the fight was set for UFC 217. Before the fight on the Joe Rogan Experience, Cody Garbrandt and Faber offered details of a cheap shot from Dillashaw that ended Chris Holdsworth's career. Dillashaw's reputation as a sucker punch and training partner had followed him around for years, but the idea that he had ended the career of one of Team Alpha Male's most promising fighters was fucked up.
We talked about it when he was still on the team also, that he had to be like reeled in a little bit, yeah. Right? He's just got a temper.
That's why you called him Killashaw?
Yeah, Killashaw, Dillashank.
It just, at the end of the bell, knees, you know what I mean? That's why Chris is out, you know what I mean? Need him in the back of the head. And I guess Chris choked him out and TJ got out and fucking kneed him in the back of the head.
When he's down, you know, on the mat.
When he was down on the mat.
In a grappling match?
At this point, it was in the realm of accusation. But a couple days before the fight, Holdsworth confirmed the story on the MMA Hour.
TJ has always been, he's been a great fighter. He's a great athlete. But he's always had like some type of competitive feud with me, you know, ever since I came to the team. I don't know if it was because of envy or jealousy or whatever it was. But, I just kind of always brush it off as him being competitive and being just ultra aggressive. And, you know, I was like, hey, let's go. You know, I was always up for the fight. But, you know, there was multiple occasions where, you know, TJ got a little bit too aggressive. He went overboard in training. He's kneeing you while we're boxing. He's throwing elbows while we're doing jiu-jitsu. And, I remember that instance that's out in the public is definitely true. I shot in on TJ and, you know, I was on all fours. He was sprawled out and he kneed me on top of the head. And that was before the Ultimate Fighter. And, I mean, I was kind of jarred up and, you know, everyone was watching and I took like 30 seconds off, but I kept going. I kept going through the rounds and I finished practice. But after that practice, I was concussed and that was my first concussion. And it just kind of, you know, kept happening from there. And
a 6-0 Ultimate Fighter winner. For a long time, Team Alpha Male have been talking about Chris Holdsworth as though he was their most talented prospect. For his career to have been cut short by an over-competitive, out-of-control, cheap-shotting teammate, it's just a tragic exit for a young fighter. An outstanding prospect who never got his chance to make his mark on his sport. And so there you have it. Team Alpha Male had spent 2 years trashing Dillashaw. And in my opinion, looking like fools doing it. But they had finally dug up something that is hard to overlook. The story is just fucked up. Everyone had taken huge public knocks. Some had done it to themselves. Others had been dragged through the mud. But everyone was dirty. Ugly, ugly rivalry. You know, they talk about settling it all in a cage. But there was really no settling this one. It went way beyond the sport. These guys had gone for blood. Their lives had been in a state of upheaval. This wasn't something that could be resolved with a simple fist fight. But the Octagon did still provide the perfect venue to vent years of pent-up rage and resentment. And that's exactly what both competitors brought into the cage. Rage, fury, pure fucking fire. The matchup was just a glorious clash of styles. Both guys are more than capable of finishing a fight in an instant. So it didn't begin with reckless abandon. The first round was a feeling out process. Dillashaw was switching stances, trying to create openings, but he was struggling. Just as he had with Cruz, Garbrandt appeared to be comfortable with the unpredictable nature of Dillashaw's movement. He initially got the better of TJ, who really couldn't find a way in. With 10 seconds left in the clock, Cody lands a vicious right hand as TJ's moving in. Dillashaw goes down, and while he's still rocked, the bell saves him from the jaws of defeat. You literally could not have scripted a more perfect sequence of events to set up the second round. TJ staggered back to his corner, still rocked. As Duane encouraged him to use more kicks, you could easily be forgiven for thinking it wouldn't make a difference. It looked like the writing was on the wall. But in the first minute of the second round, TJ landed a beautiful head kick that rocked Cody. Moments later, the two stood in the pocket, and we saw all the fury and intensity of both guys boil to the surface. They were both swinging with ruthless fucking intent. And what happened next will enter the history books as one of the most epic moments of mixed martial arts karma ever. The prior January, Cody alluded to a training knockdown. Shortly afterwards, Justin Buchholz is running his mouth all over the fucking place about how he got footage on his hard drive of TJ getting knocked out. He even teased selling it to TMZ.
Like, this is the videotape of Cody knocking out TJ, and TMZ is trying to buy it for me for 50 grand.
This threat, the threat of crossing a line and releasing training footage, persisted for almost a year. 11 months after it first came up, and the night before the fight, they released the footage. The fact that it was a knockdown didn't matter the most. Cody and Buchholz said they had the footage, TJ denied it existed, and yet here it was. In the court of public opinion, the difference between a knockdown and a knockout didn't matter. But in the reality of a fist fight, it does matter. Oh, it fucking matters. How many times have we seen guys triumph after getting knocked down, beat down, or dominated? We've seen guys getting smashed to the point where their own mothers wouldn't recognize them, and then go on to clutch victory from the jaws of defeat. That training footage should have been left on Justin Buchholz's hard drive, because although TJ's not a big shit talker, in round two he made Team Alpha Male swallow their words. Justin Buchholz is probably still choking on a big old jumbo slice of that humble pie. This is a knockdown, not a knockout. Eat this, you motherfuckers! That victory was as close to perfect poetry in motion as you're ever likely to see. It was straight up cinematic. The outpouring of fury looked like TJ Dillashaw cleansing himself of 2 years of negative emotion, pent-up rage, and resentment in one primitive, animalistic roar. In the post-fight, Cody took the loss well. He gave Dillashaw the respect he'd earned, thanked his team, but was already looking forward to a rematch, claiming he was still the better fighter.
I am the better fighter out there. I mean, he was able to capitalize on a low left hand, a right hook. Hats off to TJ. You know, he battled back from losing his title, and he was a hungry man, but I still am the better fighter in there, and I'll show that in the rematch. I just want to give a huge thanks to my coaches and my teammates at Team Alpha Male for sticking behind me, always supporting me, getting me the best prepared that I can for November 4th. You know, through everything that we've been through in the past year, I was able to go from unranked to world champion the same year, and then, you know, then we got hurt, we got injured. But they stuck beside me, they believed in me, they showed me support and love, and I'll be forever grateful for that. But I truly am the better fighter, and I want that rematch. I'm willing to put in the work and do whatever it takes to get my title back. This is something that I was born to do. This is my passion, this is my love, and I'll do whatever it takes to climb back on that mountain.
And for many, there was a ring of truth to his claim that the better fighter lost. If Cody had knocked Dillashaw down 20 seconds earlier, I might be telling a different story. If the fight proved anything, it's that both guys could win. But he didn't. Dillashaw won the day. And when the dust settled, it did settle. For the rematch, there were some shots fired back and forth, but nothing compared to the last couple of years. TJ won the day and sent an emphatic message. He crawled through a two-year river of shit, ran into the worst tornadoes imaginable, became almost universally maligned, and just as things began to turn around, he got dealt two huge blows, the Chris Holdsworth interview and the KO footage, which meant he had to face Cody in front of a New York crowd that were completely against him. He came through all that and still came out on top. And there's a clear message. Team Alpha Male threw everything but the kitchen sink. And in the end, it wasn't enough. When the cage door shut, it didn't amount to shit. You know, you can say whatever you want about TJ, but it's one thing I have to admire. A lot of men would have broken or buckled under the constant mudslide of negativity. TJ Dillashaw didn't. He fought through it all, took the hard road, and came out on top. The guy just has a great mind for fighting. Heading into the rematch, Cody found himself in a situation we've seen shit talkers in before. He either knew that because the trash talk didn't work the first time, it was pointless. Or he realized there's not much you can say when you just got your ass whooped. So we were kind of living in TJ's world. The build-up for the rematch was tame, certainly nothing compared to the volatile roller coaster of the first encounter. But the lack of drama didn't diminish the importance of the fight. Huge fight for both guys. If at UFC 223, Bruce Buffer uttered the words, "and still," for Dillashaw, that would be the sweet sound of the dirt finally hitting the coffin on his drawn-out rivalry with Team Alpha Male. Dillashaw had the opportunity to bury the feud and move on with his life. He was one win away from putting one of the more painful periods of his life behind him. And not just behind him. He would put it behind him by overcoming it all. For Cody, a loss would place him in a familiar position for Team Alpha Male. At 27, he'd have lost twice to the champion and have to start asking some serious questions about his future in a division.
Oh, dude, he's taking his second shot at the belt right now, you know? He's never even defended the belt, ever, and he's getting an immediate rematch. It's unheard of, you know? So I'm going to shut him down twice in a row, and he'll never get another shot because I'm going to be king of this weight class forever.
Year Faber couldn't overcome Cruz in the UFC. Mendes had Aldo. Benavidez had Mighty Mouse. Could Cody make the necessary adjustments and find a way to overcome TJ Dillashaw?
Yeah, I mean, let him say what he wants to do, but that motivates me, you know? And he said they're going to say you're going to ruin my career, basically take food out of my child's mouth, my family's mouth. So that's fine. I didn't need any more motivation that I already have with a new son. And also coming off my first loss, you know, I've been more motivated than I ever have over any win, and I'm healthy. I had a great camp. I made a lot of adjustments this camp.
The big rematch began the same way the first one did. Cody showing his disdain, refusing to touch gloves. The adjustment Cody made appeared to be to try to be less one-dimensional. He was throwing a lot more kicks, trying to be less predictable. 2 minutes in, and both men appeared to hurt each other. Another reminder that this fight rests on a knife edge. Either guy can finish the fight in a fucking instant. A minute later, TJ slipped, hit the mat, scrambled back to his feet. And moments later, the two fighters once again stood in a pocket, trading huge shots. One, two, third time's a charm. Dillashaw finds his mark and down goes Cody. Cody gets back to his feet but in survival mode. TJ stalks him, Cody fakes a takedown, throws a vicious right hand, but runs into a right hand at TJ's. Now it looks like a matter of time, cat and mouse. TJ buckles him with another right and proceeds to try to pound him out. Like a true warrior, Garbrandt battles back to his feet. Against the fence, TJ unloads, moves to a tight clinch, and Molly whops the fuck out of his ass. There's clearly no escape here. Cody's out on his feet. The ref steps in, and moments later, Dillashaw hears this sweet, sweet sound of the dirt finally hitting that coffin. The rivalry dead and buried.
And still, TJ Dillashaw!
This time, there was no visceral outpouring of emotion. I mean, not beyond TJ's usual insane celebration. It seemed as soon as the fight ended, he had moved on. He was calm in a post-fight interview. He looked like a guy who had absolutely, unequivocally put all the negative emotions and animosity to rest. And so it seemed the rivalry would end with an almost indifferent whimper, rather than the emphatic bang of the first fight. The significance of the victory, it wasn't really reflected in the attitude of the victor. It really seemed Dillashaw had already moved on, beyond Garbrandt, beyond his former camp.
How personally satisfying is this victory for you tonight?
Oh, it's good, man. No matter who it is, you know, getting out there and getting your hand raised is very satisfying. So, yeah, but a little extra, you know, a little extra back there. Just kind of, it's done. Close that chapter.
But I won't give the final word on a rivalry to Dillashaw. Days after the fight, Justin Buchholz, of all people, appeared on a TSN podcast, mainly to discuss UFC 227, but also the fact that he was no longer a coach at Team Alpha Male. A fact that allowed him to speak more freely on the rivalry and rewrite some of the story from his perspective. I always felt TJ was unfairly maligned in a rivalry, and Buchholz now echoed that sentiment.
You know, I love that kid, so it was like to see him to go out like that in the first round, man. That was pretty brutal, man. And TJ, I got much love for TJ too, man. He's always been throughout the whole drama between Alpha Male and Duane and me as a head coach against Duane as a head coach of two guys in the division. You know what I mean? Like, he was always cool, man. TJ was always cool. He never really stooped to the level that others might have, that maybe I even did, you know? But hey, man, I was on a reality TV star. I was trying to be a reality TV star, you know? It was a big joke for our team, and we were just building the fight, and we could do no wrong on that. I'm tough.
He also implied the Chris Holdsworth situation was a much less cut and dry matter and was likely an accumulation of damage from many gym wars and a confluence of other factors like cutting too much weight. In fact, he even seemed to imply that had Duane Ludwig been head coach earlier, it likely wouldn't have happened because Duane made the team spar smarter and take less damage in training.
Everyone's acting like Chris was like on his way to be champion, and then TJ like kneed him in the head, and then that's the whole thing. Oh, you know what I mean? Look, the guy is like 6 feet tall. He fights at 135. He's in Alpha Male old school room. You know what I mean? He got there just in time to brawl and spar the whole time under whatever coaches, you know, right before Duane got there and kind of cleaned up the act a little bit. You know, so he went through some savage times. He's cutting a ton of weight. He's a big kid, and he took a lot of damage doing that, you know what I mean? So it's not like people say that.
But he didn't just redress TJ's role in the whole thing. His final comments, they kind of cast Team Alpha Male's behavior in a much more understandable light.
Oh, it's the middle of 2016. Now we've got the momentum back. That's when Team Alpha Male versus everybody came out. Like, that was something that I was pushing. And you know, when you're down in the dumps like that, you got to have an enemy. And there's no better perfect enemy than Duane Ludwig. You know what I mean? This guy was – so he made his name as a coach off our team. He left with our champion, you know what I mean, and good friend of everyone, you know. Got him to leave California and move to Colorado, and we're just like, you know, and TJ's always like on the Ultimate Fighter. He's like, what are you saying? You told me to go. And like, I was like, yeah, man, I did. When you were, it was like, dude, at least you have a coach. What do we got over here? Like, it was bad. Everyone, like I said, everyone was leaving, and it was a tough time for the team. So yeah, I mean, he's like, he has like this dramatic moment on the Ultimate Fighter show where he like calls me out for that. And I'm like, yeah, so what? You know, I'm the head coach over here now. What do you want to do? You know, you're in our division. Cody's my guy. That was my attitude at that time, you know? And, you know, if you want to get offended by it or whatever, here's the thing, man. I took my job serious, man. I'm like, I would have poisoned you if I could have to get that win. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm out there to get the W, but. Now that we're not competing, it's all good, you know what I mean? As far as I'm concerned.
You know, it was difficult not to take sides on this one. I always felt Dillashaw was unfairly maligned. But when you hear Buchholz's depiction of events, Team Alpha Male really sounded like a fractured camp in disarray, floundering a plug holes in a sinking ship. Team Alpha Male is an MMA institution that had taken 11 years to build, and was a huge part of all their lives. For years, it was fighters training fighters, close bonds forged through blood, sweat, and tears. And so, yeah, they were prepared to fight tooth and nail, and even get a little dirty in order to hold things together. I can't really judge him for that. The split threatened their camp, and from that point on, a lot of the hands seemed to simply play themselves. The rivalry largely a consequence of circumstance rather than any real maliciousness on any one individual's behalf. And so in the end, what we're left with is a cautionary tale of overlapping ambition, converging goals, and friendship gone awry. Another story full of humanity's themes: deceit, hubris, betrayal, vaunting ambition, tragic regret, meteoric rise, crushing downfall, and ultimate redemption. It's all there. What a fucking sport.
You can break me down. You can take me down. You can take me down. You can break me down. You can take me down. Bam bam ano bom. Lord, how much more are we supposed to tolerate? Can't you see there's more to me than my mistakes? Sometimes I get this feeling makes me hesitate. I believe she won't take me somewhere I'm not supposed to be. You can steal the things that God has given me. No more pain and no more shame and misery. Papa mano, you can take me down. You can break me down. You can take me down. Papa mano, take me down. You can't break me down. You can't take me down. Bum, bum, I don't.